Penguin Random House Audio presents Atomic Spy, The Dark Lives of Klaus Fuchs, by Nancy Thorndike Greenspan. Read for you by Tavia Gilbert. To my husband, Stanley, who always believed that the children and I could do what we set our minds to. He led by example. He inspired us. And to my friend Gustav Born, who generously allowed me to write the biography of his father, Max Born, the experience that led me down this path. Prologue. Revelation, London, August 1949. On September 10th, 1949, Michael Perrin's phone rang in the middle of the night. The message was simple, direct, and urgent. Come to the American Embassy immediately. Perrin, deputy director of Britain's longtime atomic energy program, jumped in a taxi for the 5-mile trip south from Hampstead to 1 Grosvenor Square, where U.S. State Department officials hustled him into the communications room. There he learned the content of several coded telex messages from the Pentagon. The U.S. Air Force, using specially equipped planes, had detected radiation in the atmosphere. The only explanation could be the explosion of an atomic bomb. The United States needed an RAF plane to conduct additional tests to confirm the findings. 1 week later, Perrin gathered with other experts for a meeting of Britain's Joint Intelligence Committee at the Ministry of Defense at Whitehall. To the surprise of many JIC members, the room was first cleared of secretaries and anyone else who could not keep what was going to be said to himself, placing the meeting, as one observer described it, under a melodramatic bond of secrecy. A balding physicist with a serious countenance, Perrin somberly explained that the radiation detected was most likely the result of a Russian A-bomb test, most likely in the area of Lake Baikal. RAF airplanes outfitted with special filters had obtained particles which have been definitely identified as plutonium, though he acknowledged that there was still some doubt about the specifics. The committee approved Perrin and the director of MI6 to brief Prime Minister Clement Attlee at his country home, and the two men hastened up to Putney. But Attlee was already aware of these dire developments. He and President Harry Truman had been in contact by telegram. 4 years had passed since the American bombing of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, and the end of the war had brought a significant realignment of the world's major powers. Having sided with the Western democracies against the Nazis, the Soviet Union had emerged from the war, at least in the eyes of its former allies, as the greatest threat to the current peace. Joint Intelligence Committee papers had projected that the Russians would have a bomb by 1950 at the earliest, more reasonably in 1952. British military forecasting relied on these assessments. If the radiation was truly from a Russian test, how could this have happened so quickly? How could Soviet science have leaped so far ahead? In classic understatement, one participant in the meeting noted the significance of the A-bomb test in his diary. The Joint Intelligence Committee papers will, of course, have to be revised. Not far from Buckingham Palace, in an unassuming office building of ordinary brick and limestone near Hyde Park Corner, a man sat examining top-secret memos that might provide the answer to Russia's mysterious go-ahead. There was nothing about the man, Arthur Martin, to suggest international intrigue, even less so derring do. The same was true of the building nestled in among the pubs and grocery shops of Curzon Street, except perhaps for some bricked-in windows. The gun ports on one side might strike an equally odd note for the careful observer. The bricks and the ports had been devised as last-ditch insurance against German paratroopers landing in Hyde Park during the war. The architectural anomalies made sense only if one knew that the unassuming building, Leckenfield House, was the headquarters of MI5, the section of military intelligence tasked with hunting down spies on British soil. The memos in Martin's care had originated across the Atlantic, where American and British codebreakers toiling in Arlington, Virginia, had at long last made sense out of seeming nonsense. They had labored long and hard over a stack of coded messages sent between the Soviet consulate in New York and Moscow in 1944, back when the United States and the USSR were closing in on German forces from opposite sides of Europe. Now, 5 years later, the decoded threads revealed evidence of a wartime traitor. Urgency and dread pulsated through a telegraph from the British Embassy in Washington. "We have discovered material, which, though fragmentary, appears to indicate that in 1944, a British or British-sponsored scientist working here on atomic energy or related subjects was providing Russians with policy information or documents." Agent's cover name was initially Rest, subsequently changed to Charles. In July 1944, he had been working for 6 months. On one occasion, he handed over, through cutout report described as MSM-1 Part 3, subject of which appears to be fluctuations in stream or ray. "My present opinion is that this will prove grave matter." Again, British understatement held sway. Arthur Martin was relatively new as an intelligence officer at MI5, but he had a history with signals intelligence and encryption. He had spent 5 years at the government communications headquarters, securing its systems and examining those of foreign powers. Just recently, he had been made liaison between GCHQ and MI5's B branch, counter-espionage and counter-subversion, a division that was often the focus for high-profile action. For decades, MI5 had bugged the British Communist Party headquarters, routinely opened the mail of its members, and kept an eye on fellow travelers. And since the war, it had doubled its efforts. It worried as it looked to the east. Moscow's persistent pressure on Central and Eastern Europe had undermined nascent democratic governments. In March 1946, in a famous speech in Fulton, Missouri, Winston Churchill had described the Soviet menace with characteristically memorable prose. "From Stettin in the Baltic to Trieste in the Adriatic, an iron curtain has descended across the continent." In the face of Soviet expansion and propaganda, a weakened post-war economy that included continued rationing for food and gas in particular, as well as an acute housing shortage, made Britain vulnerable to leftist pressure. On the heels of World War II and the Great Depression, the austerity had pushed out conservative governments and elevated left-wing ones to power, with Churchill sent back into the wilderness and Clement Attlee's Labour government in control. A bright spot in the British firmament was science, a positive side effect of weapons research that included development of the atomic bomb. The nuclear age could give Britain the capacity to develop new forms of power and medicine, and new weapons. Many of its top scientists, partnered with their American counterparts, had tirelessly slogged in the Manhattan Project, the joint US-UK effort to build an atomic bomb, and now Britain wanted its own. Until the British achieved that milestone, the Americans had a monopoly. Or so they had thought, before detecting radiation in the atmosphere. If Russia did have a bomb, and well ahead of schedule, it would shatter the West's atomic hegemony. What would this portend for the security of Europe, and in particular, the security of England? Moscow was only 1,500 miles from London. One burdened soul later agonized that, with sufficient bombs, the Soviets could blot this country out entirely. Arthur Martin chased suspects through clues on paper, studying the messages, reviewing the files, and slowly filling in the pieces of the puzzle. The tighter the pieces fit, the clearer the patchwork scheme became, and the more effectively field agents could operate. For this assignment, he had to penetrate the clues available in the decoded messages of the Russians, and try to ferret out the traitor and what secrets he had betrayed. Hamstrung from lack of information, he could do little until the endless blocks of numbers in the coded messages yielded treasure. He waited. In a move to lift the veil, British intelligence officers in Washington told Martin that they were keen to dig into the 1944 to 1945 files on the Manhattan Project. Their information was still fragmentary, but using the specifics they had, a scientist, perhaps British or British-sponsored, working in the United States on a project probably related to atomic energy in 1944, they thought they could link the clues and identify the scientist who had betrayed them. A week later, they cabled.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.